We'd like to welcome everybody out. We're going to get this thing going this morning. We appreciate everybody being here on a Monday morning. Obviously, we've got a lot of folks from the news here, so it's going to be a fun morning. Of course, this is the study committee, the Johnny Talbert III House Study Committee on Heat-Related Injuries. And we're going to open this thing up first with a moment of prayer and a moment of silence for, of course, Johnny Talbert, but also the girl down in Clayton County as well, Miss Bell. So if Representative Butterfield bless this meeting, and then we'll follow it up with a moment of silence.
All heads bowed. Thank you, O Lord, for bringing us here to get today to be able to explore and come up with solutions for the passing of two young souls, but also to make sure we prevent any other young souls and young citizens from passing away from heat stroke and heat-related injuries. Please bless everyone here today and cover them, and thank everyone in attendance, and thank you for allowing us to be here. Amen.
All right. Appreciate that, Representative. Or Vice Chair, whichever one you want to call it. Be sure to let me know. So we're going to begin this meeting this morning with Dr. Ben. I'm not going to say your last name because I will butcher it. Come on up and you can either stand or grab the mic and sit, whatever you want to do. Appreciate you being here this
morning.
Thanks
for having me.
And how do I say the last name?
That's Lefkov.
Lefkov. And what's the originality of that?
I believe it's Russian.
Okay, right on. Well, I see it in the beard, but I didn't want to profile
it. There we go. You're doing pretty good yourself.
Yeah, thank you. Now. Appreciate you being here today.
Thank you for having me. All right, let me get set up here. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Vice Chairman. Thank you, representatives, for taking up this issue and for having me come and speak to you all today regarding heat illness and heat injury. This is a very important topic, and I appreciate being given the opportunity to educate you all regarding the burden of disease and the emergency management of heat-related illness and heat-injured patients. I was told to keep it under 30 minutes, so I'll do the best I can. And I apologize if I'm a bit raspy. My four-year-old was kind enough to share his germs with me. He's on about sharing now, so here we are.
Before you get started, here's a water.
Oh, yeah, let me grab it.
I'll help you. You said 30 minutes, and you're going to need that.
So by way of quick introduction, my name is Ben Lefkoe. I'm an emergency physician. Did my medical school at the Medical College of Georgia. I did my residency training at Grady Memorial Hospital, which is just up the road, and currently I'm the medical director for the emergency department at Emory Decatur Hospital, and I'm the chief medical information officer for the what was prior DeKalb Medical, operating three hospital operating unit, but we're called Emory Decatur now. A quick briefing on the epidemiology of heat injury. So the CDC estimates that 658 heat-related deaths annually in the U.S., and that's a fairly steady figure, if not slowly climbing. In 2016 was the second most common weather-related fatality, second to flooding. It is the highest environmental cause of death in the 30-year average time span, however. Those greater than age 65 have a higher rate of death from heat injury compared to the younger population. There is a racial disparity as well in heat illness. We see that in the Black non-Hispanic population. Most years there tends to be a higher rate of death from heat injury compared with the general population. There's probably a number of reasons for that that go towards socioeconomic factors. What is EMS response time in the field? How many hospitals are in the vicinity? What is the quality of care you're getting at these hospitals? What's the quality of the staff members working on the field? There's probably a number of things that go into that. Now that we've talked about the epidemiology, let me jump into various types of heat injury, and then I want to talk about emergency management, and then we'll talk about some recommendations, some common sense recommendations that can be taken to help prevent heat injury. So the basic pathophysiology of heat injury, so body heating under exercise exists in a continuum from safe to unsafe core temperature levels. So as the heat rises in the body, either due to heat generation from exercise or from environmental heating of the body, or both, the body will attempt to compensate for the excess heat. The compensation mechanisms include increased cutaneous blood flow, that's increased blood flow to the skin, dilation of the capillary blood vessels. So the small blood vessels that feed your organs, feed the skin, will widen or loosen to allow more blood to flow to them. You'll get a lowering of your sweating threshold. That means you'll sweat at a lower temperature than you otherwise would, and you'll increase your sweat output. That's so you can lose heat by conduction or convection in the environment. And then you'll get increase in your plasma volume. And what that means is basically the body sucks fluid out of the cells and out of the tissue surrounding the cells and into the bloodstream to increase the sweat output ultimately is the goal. All these mechanisms exist for a single purpose, and that's homeostasis. What does that mean? That means the body wants to stay at a steady state. So the brain monitors the body's temperature and will do everything it can to maintain its set core temp. If your set temp is 98.5, it's going to do everything it can to keep you at 98.5. That includes sweating, capillary, blood volume, all the stuff we just mentioned. So when these adaptation mechanisms fail, the body begins to heat. As the body heats, that's where injury starts to occur. So some initial responses to mild temperature elevations include heat cramps, heat rash, and heat edema, or swelling. You'll notice swelling in the legs, swelling in the arms, and on a hot summer day, some of us may notice some marks in our legs from our socks. That's heat edema. Some individuals may experience heat syncope, or fainting. This is due to dilation of the blood vessels, like we discussed. Your blood vessels relax and in an effort to exhaust the heat from the body. But that can also lead to a low blood pressure. Also, your body's total blood volume decreases because you're sweating so much and losing so much liquid through your sweat that it can actually make you pass out. And so that's heat syncope. As we progress into moderate heat injury, we can term that heat exhaustion. The core temp at this time is usually between 101 to 105. And these patients are fatigued, they're cramping, they're sweating, they're breathing fast, their heart rate is fast. But what's important to notice is that their mental status, their cognition is normal. They're able to speak to you, they're able to make sense when they talk. As you progress towards the most severe form, that's when we start calling it heat stroke. Now, it's important to differentiate this heat stroke as used in layman's and medical parlance from the classic strokes you hear about where you have clots in the brain causing cutoff of blood flow that certain individuals will get. Heat stroke is a little different than that, and probably stroke is a misnomer. But as we get into the heat stroke range, that's when the core temperature is exceeding 104 degrees Fahrenheit, and that's a pretty high temperature. The important differentiator between heat stroke and heat exhaustion is mental status, confusion, cognition. Patients with heat stroke are confused. You might notice shivering, disorientation, convulsive-like activity similar to a seizure, and low blood pressure if you take their blood pressure. In these patients, the organ systems start shutting down as the heat stress leads to apoptosis or programmed cell death. Stay with me here. This is a molecular mechanism which causes the gross effects that we see in the heat-injured patients. Apoptosis is where there's enough heat stress on the cell that the cell says, I cannot go on, and it basically commits a form of suicide. And that's where you'll notice that in any organ in the body, in the heart, in the kidneys, in the muscle, in the brain, anywhere in the body that's overheated, ultimately if it gets enough heat stress, those cells will start dying. And that's what leads to the dysfunction and the injury that we see in the heat-injured patients. And it's that multi-organ failure that causes these patients to die. So that's all terrifying. Let's talk about what we can do about it, what we can do to fix it. So I'm going to divide the management into two forms, pre-hospital and hospital-based management. So on the field, if an athlete goes down, what do we do? First things first, ABCs, but we've renamed it recently to CAB. So circulatory first, go over, you check a pulse, make sure that the athlete has a pulse. It may not be heat exhaustion, it may be a cardiac issue, right? So go and check a pulse, make sure they have a pulse. Then you wanna make sure they're breathing and make sure their airway is clear. There's not any matter in their airway. Then we proceed with, if we suspect a heat injury, you need to do two things, call 911 and cool the patient. When you look back at a lot of the heat injury cases, these patients were not cooled fast enough. And if you think about a 20-minute EMS arrival, load, and departure time, plus transit to the hospital, plus unload at the hospital, you've built in a lot of times when these patients are hot and continuing to get injured. As long as they're hot, their body is being injured. So you must cool the patient. Ideal circumstance, what can you do? Take all the patient's clothes off of them and submerge them in an ice bath. If you have that, that'll be the fastest way that you can cool a patient. I wish I had an ice bath at my hospital. In the suboptimal circumstance, You can still remove as much clothing as possible. Place ice packs over the large blood vessels, both sides of the neck, in the armpits, and in the groin. The blood vessels there are large and shallow, and as you cool them, it will cool the blood that's passing by and will help cool their core temperature down. Fans are helpful too. You can, especially if they're undressed, you can blow air across the skin, and through convection, they'll lose a lot of heat that way. So that's about all you can do in the field. Once you're in the hospital, again, once they hit our door, we'll do our ABCs, make sure we check the most important and basic parts first. And then we'll get a core temperature, usually through a rectal probe, and check and see what their temperature is. And then we'll start active cooling if it's severely elevated. So that'll involve ice baths if you have it, packing the patient down with ice over the big blood vessels like we mentioned. Also, cold IV fluids can be used. There's some other more extreme measures like putting Foley catheters in the bladder and putting running cold water or cold saline through the bladder to help core the insides. The goal is to get you down to around 102 Fahrenheit in about 20 minutes. So that's the speed we're looking to do this in. You want to try not to overshoot because you have to think the body's thermostat is turned all the way down to cold. Make myself as cold as possible. And so when you start actively cooling them, you could easily overshoot and go too cold and cause some issues that way as well. The next step would be recognition. So what we want to do is identify any organs that could be damaged from the heat stroke. So we'll be checking electrolytes, kidney function, we'll be checking for rhabdomyolysis, or rhabdo, some people know of, which is muscle breakdown from the heat. That's a really important one to recognize because the muscle breakdown can damage the kidneys, and some of that can be irreversible. So it's important that we recognize that early, and that can be one of the reasons why the patients ultimately need to be admitted to the hospital if they do have significant muscle breakdown. We'll do an EKG, we'll often do a chest x-ray as well. We will treat the patients and decide whether to admit or discharge them from the hospital depending on how severe the organ injury is. If they hopefully don't have any signs of major end organ injury, they could be okay to go home. If they have signs of any sort of end organ damage, they'll get admitted to the hospital. So prevention. So I was looking through a few of the different guidelines, and probably the best one is the American College of Sports Medicine. And I have over here, if y'all would like them, I printed out the guidelines for everyone, which I can disseminate to you.
Yeah.
Here you go.
So there should be a few extra copies here. I'll let y'all pass that down.
And so the guidelines are a little bit broad, but I'll go through some of the parts on there that I thought were pretty common sense and applicable to what we're trying to do here. So acclimatization is a big form of prevention. So a lot of the heat injuries that we see, and a lot of the injury and a lot of the heat-related fatalities that we see, especially in football, soccer, the late summer, early fall sports, are at the beginning of the season. The patients or the athletes are in the poorest shape of the season, and it's during the hottest times of the year that they're exercising. And so it's important to have a slow ramp up. The body will be able to accommodate the higher temperatures better when it's in better shape than it can coming right off the bench when they're not in shape. And so you're more prone to heat injury at the beginning of the season than you are later on in the season. Now, of course, it's not as hot later on in the season, so how can you prove that? And you can't. But we do see at the beginning of the season, there's a higher rate of injury than there is later on in the season. You need to ensure adequate breaks for hydration. So once you start dehydrating, then you're losing some of that compensatory mechanism. You lose the ability to sweat. You lose the ability to shunt blood to the skin to cool you off. Ensure adequate shape. You need to be able to lower your temperature. You can passively lower it by decreasing the amount of heat coming onto you and by breaks and resting to decrease the amount of heat that your body is generating. Avoid alcohol and drugs. So we know that athletes who are using stimulants, caffeine, patients or athletes who are using alcohol or drugs are at increased risk of heat injury. And so it goes without saying that should be avoided. You can review the guidelines that I've handed out to you, and there's a number of common sense guidelines in there. One of them they recommend is avoiding play above a wet bulb temp of 90. That seems a little restrictive, and I'm not going to pretend to know how to calculate the wet bulb to regular temperature up here, but it's not that high, and so it would preclude a lot of sports from happening. So we'll have to take these, you know, as they come. They are guidelines only. There is a paucity of high-quality research that would inform us what to do in these cases when you compare it to other forms of medical illness or injury that we know of. However, It's my opinion that we should borrow what we know from other popular and deadly conditions like stroke, heart attacks, cardiac arrest, and trauma, and that's awareness. So it's very important that we focus on increasing awareness among coaches, among lay people, among sideline staff, so they can say, this is heat stroke, this is an emergency. Just like we do when we say, this is a heart attack, this is a stroke, right? We need staff to be able to recognize the emergent nature of it and not be complacent around it, and then it can get treated faster, and hopefully we can reduce the burden of injury and burden of disease. Additionally, we need to improve we need to improve infrastructure at the field themselves. So many collegiate programs will have ice baths, or they'll have coolers of some type there, but there's no shortage of ice at a sports game, and there's usually no shortage of ice at a practice. And so knowing what you can do on the field can help immediately address the issue before the patient is already irreversibly injured by their heat injury. So that's what I have for you today. Thanks for allowing me to come in and chat with you, and I'm available for any questions if you have them.
Absolutely. I got one first.
I do have one.
You go first.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I appreciate it. You did talk a lot about making sure at the fields themselves that you are able to cool the body as quickly as possible, and I do hear that submerging the athlete in ice bath is the best way. A lot of high schools and, of course, youth athletic leagues don't have an ice bath. So what's the next best alternative to an actual submerging in an ice bath? So
the next best is going to be ice packs and packing the neck, armpits, and groin.
Okay.
And removing the clothing. You have to remove the clothing.
Thank you.
I also think that, you know, if you start removing clothing and stuff, that'll kind of help, you know, it'll weed out whether it's an issue or not. You know, sometimes as a coach, it's hard to, as you're pushing kids and trying to get them ready, it's trying to determine, is this real, is this mental, what's going on? So, I mean, I think that's what the challenge is for coaches as well. So, I think if you start putting kids in ice baths, that'll pretty much eliminate the ones that don't necessarily need the ice bath, but just, you know, maybe don't want to exert themselves. My question is this, if you have had a history of heat-related injuries, do you become more susceptible to that over time?
I don't know the answer to that, but I believe it's no.
Okay, yeah, if you'll check on that and just email me. I was just interested to know, because we had a kid one time that played baseball with us that he didn't sweat a lot, right? So he would always, you know, he'd get to a certain point, we'd have to pull him out of the game and ice him down, and then it just seemed like it was reoccurring. So I didn't know if once you've done some damage at some point, if it happens.
And there's other populations that are more susceptible to you. You have to think about patients or athletes that have sickle cell trait or sickle cell disease. They're going to be much more susceptible to injury if they overheat or if they get severely dehydrated. And so that's one population you certainly have to be careful of. And there was an athlete, I believe it was in Maryland, a college athlete, who died with sickle cell trait because he got overheated.
And actually, at our last meeting, the guy that came and talked was just outside of Maryland, too, so he talked a lot about that issue.
Yeah.
One other question. Would you guys be interested, as we follow through this, and I really appreciated what you said about awareness, because I think that's a lot of it. That's a great common sense approach. Would you guys be interested in helping do a video that we could send out to all the Parks and Rec guys?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, great. Appreciate you. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Now we have a great group from Rank One Health. You guys will slide up. There's three of you. Introduce yourself. If you want to take that mic and sit at the table, that would be great. Did they get you squared away on your video? Or the app? That's awesome. she had a heat-related knee injury right there.
Yeah.
I said the same thing as
well. That's
why I'm not giving it up soon enough.
Yeah.
I said the same thing this morning. Mr. Chairman and Committee, thank you so much for having us this morning. My name is Mitch Hall. I'm here as part of the leadership team for Ranklin Sport and Ranklin Health. I want to talk to you today about a platform that's been deployed in Texas and 25 states across the country that are related to heat-related illnesses as well as all injuries in sports. One moment.
Hi, I'm Terry Lukowski. I'm with Ranklin Health.
Hello, I'm Tracy Neely. I'm with Ranklin Health. We're happy to be here today.
Gentlemen, 12 years ago in the state of Texas, a platform called Ranklin Sport was deployed. Today, it's in over 4,500 schools in Texas and 25 states across the country, including the great state of Georgia. Last year alone, 3.1 million injuries and treatments were captured in this database that were available for study by all the states and all the individual cities and all the individual schools involved. About a year and a half ago, Children's Health Andrews Institute and Ranklin Sport partnered up and did a joint venture that's now called Ranklin Health. Essentially what we did, gentlemen, is we built an app that enables Ranklin Sport, the athletic trainers that use Ranklin Sport, and the coaches that use Ranklin Sport to immediately connect with doctors, hospital systems, and providers that are in their community, as well as their team docs as well. We are here today to talk about those injuries and how we're going to collect and provide that data to you in the future. And I'm also going to do a quick demonstration of the app as well. Along with those $3.5 million injuries that were recorded last year, along with the treatments, what Ranklin Health essentially does is allow that doctor to connect immediately. If you have a heat-related illness happening right there on the field or during practice, they can enter that injury into our platform. They can immediately connect the doctor, like Dr. Lefkoe that spoke just a few minutes ago, and he can help them work through those protocols within minutes. As a matter of fact, the very first consult that we did in Prosper, Texas, their quarterback was hurt really bad on the field. 8 minutes after he was hurt, we had him on video with a physician doing a concussion protocol. That's absolutely unheard of. It's never been done that way. So I'm going to take a moment here and demonstrate the application for you and then give you an opportunity to ask us any questions that you may have.
Ma'am, does it show up okay, or do we have to turn the lights off? I mean, don't go too dim. I'm a little nervous voting this up. Yeah, that's perfect.
So, gentlemen, there are two apps. One's called Ranklin Sport. Ranklin Sport is the app that the schools use. The administrators use it, the coaches use it, athletic trainers and directors use it. There's another app called Ranklin Health. The physicians are in the Ranklin Health app. The Ranklin Sport app is FERPA and HIPAA compliant from a technology perspective. The Ranklin Health app is HIPAA compliant from a technology perspective. So all the information that exchanged in between these two apps are HIPAA compliant and are secure. So opening Ranklin Sport, I preloaded this, and gentlemen, this is a test environment. I'm doing it on my phone. On both sides of it, typically you would have the athletic trainer on the field, and you'd have a physician away that is on their own phone. But when I'm doing it on one phone, I have to kind of switch back and forth a little bit. So
I
ask for your patience there. So in here, I can go into athletes. I can pick the school. Oops, sorry guys. I'm gonna put in the last name of our test patient. I'm gonna actually kill the app and reopen it one moment. I call this the technology gods.
Just be careful as you start flipping back through there now. The news is here. You don't want to get that on. It's Monday. It just come on fresh off the weekend.
So here, I'm gonna choose Prosper High School.
Oh yeah, there you go.
And I'm going to search for a test student. Here I see my pick. Now you notice on here there are kids in red and green.
The kids who are in green are eligible, and they are compliant, and they are ready to play sports for or any activity they're in. If they're red, that means they're out of compliance from some aspect. It could be they could be missing forms. They could be out on a current injury, and they haven't been returned to play or returned to learn yet. And so that lets the coaches know as they look at these dashboards that, you know, green means go, red means they can't play, which is a big piece of it. Here I'm going to select Michael Henry. Here is where you can see the student's profile. You can see all the forms they have filled out from the school's perspective. You can see their injury history, their treatment history, and any athlete files that are associated as well. So I'm going to go to injury history here. Here I see two injuries that have been submitted. One was while he was playing baseball and one while he was playing basketball. I can also go in here and create a new injury by filling out all this information listed here, which really takes about probably 10 or 15 different clicks to get through. It can certainly be done in less than 1 minute. You can also see all the team docs that are listed there. You can see whether they require surgery, whether they're eligible to participate, any notes to the coach, as well as any medical notes that are related to the physician.
Hold that thought just a second.
Yes, sir.
So when you click that physician for this particular injury, it sends that physician an email or a text and lets them know that, hey, this is what's happening, you're an ortho, he had a knee injury, just heads up.
Yes, sir, I'm about to cover that.
Okay, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay, it's a great question.
I get ahead of myself.
No, it's okay. We went ahead last night and preloaded a couple of injuries, and again, this is a test patient, so I don't have absolutely every field filled out, but it's very comprehensive.
Sure.
So here's the injury that they had, here's how it happened. Here's all the information that was selected, the doctor they were referred to, and again, any notes that were there. And any notes are also in transaction. Now, the most important piece of this, of the information that's being sent to the doctor, is not only the current injury, it's every single injury this child has had since they've been in seventh grade. So if they are playing on a varsity team, they're a junior in high school, they've been a rank one sport customer since they were in seventh grade, we can see every single injury that's happened to them. So the doctor can take that into consideration while they're coming up with their information they're going to send back, the consultative advice they're going to send back to them. So I'm going to back out of that. And I'm the athletic trainer, I'm on the field, I've just kind of stabilized this kiddo, and I want to know a little bit more about what's next to do. So I'm going to go hit this green bubble up top, right here. I'm going to go in here, and I'm just going to search for myself here. There it is. I'm going to select that, I'm going to select myself here, I'm going to hit start chat. So I've selected the doctor. Now I'm going to click on the little red button at the bottom. I'm hooked up to a projector here, so it's not playing nice with me. There we go. I'm going to search by school. I'm going to put in Prosper. I'm going to put in last name Henry. I see Michael Henry. I'm going to select a pre-existing injury. That's the one we entered just this morning with Tracy and I. I'm going to select it. I'm going to make any notes. I'm going to say he broke his leg on the field. I've already set it. Done. I can go ahead and add an early treatment here too if I want to. I'm going to send the overview, and you're going to see immediately up top from the health app. I'm going to pop up here in a second now. There it is. Michael Henry's been injured. It's going to load that information. I touch that bottom red. And here at the top, you have the injury, which is loading. You have the injury. You have also the injury history here at the bottom. So that's that second injury you saw listed. Any treatments that have been associated, but it's a new injury, so there's not any at the moment. This is the student's profile. This is where they can upload return to play information. And this is all the medical notes that have been discussed about that kid, about that injury, as well as the past injuries. Gentlemen, it's that simple. I can upload pictures, I can upload videos, and from here, I can tap this button. And I'm joining a call right now.
That's amazing.
Thank you, gentlemen. for your time. Any questions?
Oh yeah. I got one. What did you get?
Yes, sir.
You got one, Coach?
No, I'm good. That's a good share.
Hey, Chief. Thanks. Thursday apartment, got anything? You would think with all these microphones and politicians, you wouldn't be able to, you'd be able to get these things spoken a little bit better.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For a small community, maybe 10,000 people in the county, so you've got a school system that might have 2,000 students in it. How expensive is it for this service for the athletes? And
sir, for rank one sport, it's $600 a year and a $600 setup fee. For health, it's free. Or it's at no cost to the school. There's no cost to the parents either.
So it's 600 set up and 600 reoccurring every year?
Yes, sir. First for the sport piece.
Yeah, yeah. And so I guess my next question would be, obviously this is good information to have for the hospital, so that's kind of who's going to be footing the bill on the backside. That's how the funding, I mean, if I'm trying to figure out how you, where
yes,
your income's coming from. Because obviously you're not a nonprofit, you've got to make money. So my question would be, will there be an issue, like he said, eventually where it is not cost effective for you guys in the small areas, but of course it would be profitable for you in Atlanta. Is there a way to make it where you know, if you do it, it's statewide? I guess
yes,
that's what I'm saying, because eventually, you know, I'm in business, I get it. If I can't make money over here and I make money here, eventually you just go where you make money, because that's how business works, so I get that. But that would be a concern of representative purpose, I believe.
Yes, sir. You know, as you say, we're unable to give the health care away for free, even consultative advice. It's free to the school, the providers, the local hospital systems, and the independent provider practices are the ones that subscribe at a pretty low price point to the platform. What we're actually more interested, sir, is being able to collect the data and share that data with the state and with the local and federal government, so we can look at this data and see how best we can help children that have been injured, not just from heat-related injuries, that's certainly the point of this meeting, but from all injuries from across the board, and to also loop the parents into that communication so that they understand what's happening with their child, when it's happening with their child, and getting them into that position as quick as possible, because we know and recognize in a healthcare issue that can be cumbersome at times.
Sure. It's a great app, for sure.
I think our goal in being here today is, as you guys are working with the study committee and trying to figure out what recommendations to make, is that, you know, some states have looked at mandatory reporting of injuries, you know, better access to medical personnel. You know, our technology solution can be something that is a great asset statewide, and that if we adopted it on a statewide basis, it would be at, you know, zero cost to the schools. For us to implement that across the board, it provides more uniformity in the system, so it makes it easier, more efficient. You know, to the doctor's point, if that, you know, on the field, if they had a rank one app in this situation that happened here, they would have been able to consult with the doctor immediately, such as someone, you know, as esteemed as the doctor who spoke before us, and could walk them through those protocols. So no, if you make a video, that video could be uploaded to our app, but also they could have access in real time to the doctors to help prevent these types of situations from escalating. And I think that's our goal, is across the state to figure out how we can partner with your committee to be the solution at no cost to the schools to help do that.
My question would be, how would it work for the, like in this case, what happened to, unfortunately, happened to John Tolbert here at Welcome Park? How does that system work with a youth athletic league, an independent league, where we're not talking about an actual school? And a lot of times we don't have trained athletic trainers on the scene. So who would be, or at the practices or at the game, so who would be the individuals responsible, and how would this system work with youth athletic league?
The coach or the administrator for that league could certainly have access to rank one sport as well. And that's actually the beauty of it. They can connect with a physician immediately, and that physician can walk them through what next steps to take, what to look for. Of course, you would never abandon your 911 protocol. That's first things first. Take care of that business first. Once you get the patient, or the, I'm sorry, the student stabilized, then you can reach out to the physician, get the physician through the messaging platform or through the video platform immediately. In those cases that we've seen in our beta schools in the state of Texas, we actually had the doctor in over video before the ambulance arrived.
And so that $600 cost, or recurring $600 cost, would be, I guess, billed to the athletic league.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, just kind of thinking big picture here, I see where the app works really great for middle school and high school, but it may be a challenge in the Parks and Rec area. Just, you know, because you don't have a consistent trainer / consistent coaches / consistent anything in Parks and Rec sometimes. So I could see where that would be an issue. But I think I don't have the data in front of me, but I imagine that I think it would be fair to say that most injuries occur from middle school and up. Most rec leagues, for the most part, don't have too many injuries. So
we are trying to capture those injuries, too.
Right. And you guys, you have a pilot program working now in Georgia. How's that going?
It's going great. We're in a small percentage of schools now. We're looking to grow.
Sure. And what remind us what those areas are again?
I don't have the direct areas in front of me, but I can send them to you.
I got you. We talked about last time, but I've slept since then.
Yes, sir.
And it's Monday. So.
Yes, sir.
Well, great. You guys, anybody have anything else? No? That's great.
Thank
we
you.
Appreciate you being here. We'll talk later.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you. Mr. Chair, can I? Mr. Chair, can I take a small privilege to make a recognition right now, if you don't mind?
Come in.
Whatever you want to do is fine with me there, Representative Bowie.
I really want my esteemed colleague to stand and be recognized. Representative Mary Robichaud, the gentlewoman from Roswell, thank you so much for coming out. She's been a steward in the area of healthcare, health-related legislation and policy. So thank you for coming all the way down from North Fulton to be here today.
On a Monday.
And my last one, I definitely want to make sure I recognize City Councilwoman Helen Willis, Representative District 3, which is, we're in her city district, municipal district, but she's been just an amazing advocate. She was at the first study committee at the Capitol back in June the 10th. So thank you, Helen, for helping us today to get set up and all the logistics, and thank you so much for all you do. And everybody else, welcome to House District 62. That's my mission.
62 in the house. Yes, I echo what he said about having us here today. You've done a great job putting this together, and I know this is a very important issue for you guys, and your concern is really noted for sure. Thanks for being here. And Ms. Mary was actually up in North Georgia here about 2 weeks ago. So not only is she concerned about heat-related injuries, but also economic development throughout the state of Georgia. So she's everywhere. All right. We're gonna move on here. Mr. Tony Phillips, Parks and Rec, South City of South Georgia. Come on down. Also, as he's coming up, there's refreshments in the back. Feel free to get you water, bag of chips, whatever it is. And lunch is coming up soon.
Good morning, committee members. My name is Tony Phillips. I am the director for the City of South Portland's Department of Parks and Recreation. We operate 17 parks across nearly 700 acres for a city of roughly 100,000 residents. And so I'm here today to share with you the perspective from Parks and Recreation from the ground, and what we do each and every day, and what we've tried to do to address this all-important issue. I wanted to begin by talking just for a few brief minutes about our programming model, specifically as it relates to youth athletics. I think it's unique to Parks and Recreation, the point you were making a little earlier. Here in the city of South Fulton, we partner with nonprofit 501c3 youth athletic associations currently. We do that, of course, in what we refer to as a facility use agreement that has a number of stipulations, operation, and otherwise, that govern our partnership with these organizations. We use them in a number of areas. Football is primarily one of them, but we also use them for baseball and soccer as well. These associations are largely, as probably are, what are made up of volunteer coaches, which is what makes what we do in parks and recreation somewhat unique, in that we have to find ways to optimize working with volunteer coaches that come from varied backgrounds. Sometimes we have some old high school athletes, some folks who've never coached the game before. So it's a really diverse group of volunteer coaches that we end up dealing with. And then our age is fairly wide range. We start as early as 5 and under for flag football, and go all the way up to about 14 when you start to get into the middle and high school age athletics. So one of the things I think is particularly unique about the city of South Fulton and was guided by the wisdom of our council is we did something fairly unique, I believe, which is in our parks ordinance, actually section 11-702, we built into our parks ordinance a requisite certification for volunteer coaches. What we recognize is that most volunteer coaches come from those diverse backgrounds I mentioned earlier. There's no telling what, if any, type of training they may have had prior to coming on board and actually working with children. So we took a proactive step to address that issue. Our ordinance in part reads, all athletic association team managers, coaches, and assistant coaches are required annually to attend a certification clinic conducted by the city prior to the start of their season. So that was step one. We wanted to make sure that we required a certain level of basic training so that we understood and would know that all coaches had at least some information on best practices around heat and hydration, as well as concussions. The next step was we reached out to the sports medicine program at Children's Healthcare Atlanta, because we wanted to make sure that training or certification would be conducted by healthcare professionals. So what we've done each year under the city is we have partnered with Children's Healthcare Atlanta. They have one of the only programs in the country dedicated exclusively to caring for adolescent and teen athletes, and we brought them out each preseason, typically during the month of June, and required all of our coaches to attend a certification session that is led by these healthcare professionals. It covers many of the topics that you've already heard about today in some detail: dehydration, heat cramps, heat exhaustion, heat stroke, as well as best practices for what we call hydration keys. How often should you hydrate? At what age? That varies by age and by weight. And so these healthcare professionals come out and educate our coaches so that at least we know they have a base of information to understand how to manage hydration and to keep our children safe. We found this to be really key to making sure that there's some level of basic training, because again, the unique aspect of what we do is that we connect the volunteers. These aren't paid professionals like you may even have at the high school level, or certainly beyond. These are volunteers who are not only unpaid, but as I mentioned earlier, they come from a variety of different backgrounds. We think we're unique in that regard in that it is a part of our ordinance, and so it's not something that we speculate or that we do from time to time. It's literally written into the ordinance that the city council passed, and so it's something that we're mandated to do each year. The partnership with Children's Healthcare Atlanta has been really productive in that I think the coaches get quality training and are able to at least have basics. Now, it is not at the level that it may be for professionals and others, but is it at least knowledgeable enough for them to understand how to watch for those signs of heat illness, what to do if they come across a case of heat illness? There was some discussion earlier about quickly immersing people into ice packs, water, things of that nature. Those are key aspects that a coach needs to be aware of if, in fact, there is an incident that they need to address. And so we've taken this proactive step, and we think it is productive and that coaches in our program today are far better qualified to not only recognize heat illness, but to know how to respond when they do recognize those heat illnesses. And with that, I will take any questions that you may have.
Mr. Phillips, thank you so much for being here. I know we have had numerous conversations in regards to injuries and youth athletics. My question is two-part. One, is it any type of, Mrs. Echo on what the chair stated earlier, is it any type of tracking mechanism or required disclosures by these volunteer coaches if any of the youth are involved in these major injuries like heat stroke or concussions? Do they have to report that to you all?
Yes, they do. It's built into the facility use agreement approved by the city council that we execute with each one of these nonprofits. Any incidents of health related injuries, things of that nature, are required to be reported to the department so that we can track and understand where we may have a problem or where we may detect patterns that are concerning.
Now, my next question, if you have one coach or one team that's repeatedly having heat-related injuries or concussions. What is the protocol for dealing with that type of situation?
One of the reasons for requiring them to report is for that very reason, so that we can track what's going on with these associations. Ultimately, once we provide the training, it's our expectation that best practices are being followed. If we detect a pattern that suggests that that is not the case, we have the wherewithal, the ability within that agreement to address that forthrightly, even if that means termination of the program. Health and safety is just uncompromised. We understand that in the city, and we've taken a position to make sure all of our coaches are trained. But along with that comes a responsibility to utilize that training appropriately, to take the issue seriously. We've been through enough here in our system where we understand the importance of that. And so we keep them accountable for following those best practices. And to your point, Representative Bodie, if we detect that there's a pattern that is not adhering to those health guidelines, that's something we would address forthrightly and definitively.
Thank you so much, Ms. Bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have a quick question, Phillips. Each year, are they required to do this? Is this yearly, annually?
Annually. So they're required to do it each preseason, and so it's annual.
During that time span, if one coach leaves and another one comes in to replace that coach, that do they have something in place where that coach, before they get on the field, have to go through that protocol also?
Excellent question. So what we provided, because we only do those trainings at specific times during the year, is that persons may seek written approval by the department for satisfaction of certification requirements through a non-city organization, which at a minimum educates and trains on concussion protocols, heat and hydration safety, and how to safely and successfully run athletic organization. That is to say, if you come in to coach after we've conducted those, you can appeal to the department and provide the information where you can attain that certification through a non-city entity. And if we approve that, then you're allowed to coach. So we want to make sure if you come on board and you did miss the training, that you do have a department-approved certification training. There's some online options for that. We prefer the face-to-face whenever possible, but there are some other options that we would consider for approval if the coach comes on after those clinics have taken place.
All right, so I guess I got one quick question here. At all your parks, do you currently have ice machines at all your parks?
No, we do not. We do not have ice machines available. Part of that training is to make coaches aware, again, of what is required. And so it is based upon that training expectation that those associations are providing water and ice at all practices. Okay. And so there aren't ice machines available, but that expectation and responsibility is there in the county.
Okay. So, yeah, I know as we're moving through the process of this committee and possible legislation, I know that to most of us, an ice bath scenario seems like a fairly cheap solution that could happen, but you're dealing with 17 parks, so that's $1,700. That's the easy part. It's the ice on site, I think, that's going to become the issue. So we just kind of have to walk our way through that.
Sure. We took an additional step of making sure, in addition to the heat and hydration training, that the head coach and each staff must also be required to be CPR certified. And so that's an annual certification. So we tried to undergird as much good information and training as possible. Again, recognizing that we work with volunteers. But I think if you have that best practice training, at least we can respond if necessary, or better yet, take preventative measures to try to prevent having those situations begin.
Ms. Phillips, I have one more set of questions. First of all, the training that you spoke of earlier, is that training monitored and conducted by your partner, Children Healthcare of Atlanta?
It is. They fully conduct the training. We have staff on site, of course, to make sure that coaches are attending, but it's conducted solely by the staff from Children's Healthcare. It's about a four-hour training that takes place. We do it all in one day, and so we typically do it on a Saturday. So about a four-hour training for the heat, hydration, and concussion. And then the second half of the day is when we bring in CPR certification for head coaches. And so we try to get all of that done in a single sitting. It's hard to corral a bunch of volunteer coaches. So we try to make it an efficient day. The first half of the day is Children's Healthcare of Atlanta conducting the training I referenced. The second half of the day is CPR certifications.
I guess one more question. Have you presented this model to
the State Department of Parks and Rec, Steve Carden, those guys, if you talk?
I have not, but I intend to try to take advantage of that, the GRPA, and also to talk with the state as well. To the best of my knowledge, I think we're one of the few municipalities that has this written into the ordinance, so that it's not subjective, it's not up to when somebody decides to do it, it's required. I think that may be a best practice, it could be a model for others.
Absolutely, and I'm sure Steve, he's a good friend of mine, Steve is, so I'm sure that he will, he would enjoy to have this information. So.
Well, certainly.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
We didn't have much choice, we're here with you. Thank you for coming on today. All right. You want to? Yeah, absolutely. Mr. Carl Green from Westlake High School, come on down.
Good afternoon. First off, I want to start by telling you all I'm in my 16th year in athletics as a coach and athletic director. My third year over at Westlake High School, and familiar with Westlake High School, you're actually in the area where Westlake is, about 10 minutes down the road. Kind of what we do here at Westlake High School, one of the main things we do, we're governed by Georgia High School Associations, as well as governed by Fulton County Schools. Part of what the things we have to do with initiative is, one, all my coaches have to be CPR AED trained, which we took advantage of that. Had over 30 odd coaches, 30 different coaches, assistant coaches and head coaches. Children's Health Carolina did that CPR AED training for us. And that's a, you know, every 2 year training. The next thing, they have to have the concussion protocol training that goes to Georgia High School Association. I have to go to different heat related trainings through Georgia High School Association. So kind of what the things we do with the hot weather and the humidity here in Georgia, and that really affects my softball program, my football program, cross country early on. A lot of my other sports are not affected by the heat. Track somewhat later in the spring, but everything is affected early by my fall sports. So those coaches, you know, we have an Emory trainer in our program. We have pretty much all the Fulton County schools, except for I think a few we have Northside, but we have Emory Healthcare as our trainers. Emory Healthcare provides us a trainer for our events, and they, of course, they're there in the most volatile sports first, but, you know, they keep the heat bulb, wet bulb for the heat related, and if it goes over 90, you know, we're shutting down activity. As a matter of fact, a lot of our practices for the first part of the year have been inside for that reason, because it was so hot. And then another thing we do is a lot of rest, a lot of breaks. We do have ice machines, get ice baths, you know, we have the tubs, whirlpool tubs, make sure everybody is, if that ever came about, we were prepared for it. And then the next thing, you know, like I tell my coaches all the time, we use a lot of common sense methods, you know, because the kids nowadays don't necessarily have the same exposure to heat as we might have had in the past. So what we do is make sure that, you know, any signs, water, 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 we have a water boy sports, water machine that everybody can get water. We have numerous water breaks, numerous times, and as a matter of fact, Georgia High School makes it go through an acclimation period, where it's a helmet for 5 days, helmet and shoulder pads next 5 days, before you get into the full pads of it, so those kids do not, you know, just go straight out to the equipment with all that heat and heavy equipment on them to wear them down. So that's pretty much what we do as far as the football related, but for all sports, again, it's a rest, acclimated to the weather, make sure they have a physical on file, and speaking, just listen to the doctors and doctor and the programs. We use a program called Dragonfly Max in Fulton County Schools. Dragonfly Max is similar to the program that was shown here, where basically everybody, all the information is entered into a portal, a safe portal, all of your history information, all of your physicals, concussion forms, sign-off sheets for Georgia High School, sign-off sheets for Fulton County, all of that information is there. And what my trainer would do in the event somebody got injured, or as a matter of fact, it happened just last week for one of my football players. It takes a guessing game out of if a kid is good, if a kid is not. The trainer is putting that note on the Dragonfly Max to show them, hey, they have an injury, sitting out, rest, limited contact, things of that nature. So that's what we use the Dragonfly Max. It's free to our school to use. It's free for all of our schools to use it. So we take advantage of that. And then another thing, like I said, with the trainers being there, they help a great deal in, you know, coach might not see the kid on the field, on the sideline, the trainer might see the kid just came out and taking a break. They can spend special attention as well, so that helps a lot. But like I said, the wet bulb helps us a lot with the heat, because again, it can go from under 80 on the wet bulb to off the turf and beating on the practice field. It gets real hot, it can be 90. And you know, that's what we called it, and say, you know, rest or shorts and things like that. And we even did something different this year as well. We went to 6 o'clock in the morning practice, well before the sun comes up, just to be prepared to make sure that we still practice and prepare for a game, but we don't take the risk of it later in the day, 4 or 5 o'clock after school is super hot, and my kids are definitely kept safe. One of the other things we have, part of the partnership we have with the county, with Emory Healthcare, Dr. Whitley out of Emory Medicine in Smyrna, he's actually our doctor, so what happens like on Friday nights, again, he's on the sidelines. If it's any kind of follow-up, our kids can go to him and go be seen and check and make sure all of the things that need to be just a follow-up from the week are done to make sure our kids are healthy. And again, it's me, like I said, one thing we do is just make sure we follow the protocols. We're using common sense. We definitely take care of our kids though they're our own. We want to make sure that everybody is up to date with physicals. We want to make sure everybody's up to date with concussion protocol. As a matter of fact, this Friday night we played one of our local teams, Creekside, and our quarterback took a nice hit. Well, actually, he's going through the concussion testing today with our trainer just to make sure that everything is fair and fine and he can go back to practice. So we take the necessary steps, and I pride myself in doing that because I want to make sure that all these things are done, make sure our kids are safe, make sure that the coaches understand that, you know, these things must be done for our kids to go return home with their parents and do what they're supposed to do the next day.
Yeah, let me think through this just a minute. So, with the incident that happened down in Clayton County, I know nobody likes to talk about the elephant in the room sometimes, but what GHSA has mandated all this, but for some reason this particular incident fell through the cracks. And I just, you know, as a statewide concern, what can we do to make sure? I mean, I guess just kind of talking through it with you. There's a rule, and if the rule's not followed, I mean, I don't know how we solve that. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we could create another law, but it's already mandated by the GHSA. If people don't follow, they don't follow, I guess.
So, like I said, for me, as an athletic director at Western High School, I say it time and time again, I really take pride in my job as a coach. I'm a father as well, but as a coach, when you're talking about overseeing, we have over 2,000 kids at Western High School. I have 160 kids in my football program. So, for me, I have to make sure that the coaches understand, hey, I know you want to win a ball game, coach, but at the end of the day, it's more about these kids' safety. And so one of the things that, just use that day, my county athletic director, Dr. Kraft, sends out an email and says, hey, temperatures will be as high as it's been, and God knows when. Make sure you all use common sense, have your heat bulb, and stay close to my weather. I'm looking at the weather as well. And I believe the heat index that day was crazy high, and I said, you know what, cross country is inside on the inside track, football, you won't go. He said, we're going to go tomorrow morning, softball, council practice, and it was just, you know, like I said, that common sense kind of hit to when you say, okay, it's so hot, the game is not until 3 days from now, got 2 more days of practice, that's just use better judgment, and that's, when it comes down to it, you know, we can study, we can read, we can take all the tests, we can do all of that. But if your gut feeling kind of lets you know, that's kind of how I take the approach as well, because all of the testing and stuff is good. But you know when it's, you know, as a coach, you'll be out there and you can feel a little toasty yourself. So you just imagine the kids with equipment on and running and things like that. That's kind of how my approach is with it as well. Because I still follow the guidelines, but That approach, you know, like it's a thunderstorm, you know, we gotta be 7 miles with our lightning detector. If I see that cloud getting darker and it's coming closer, sometimes I skip the 7 mile route. Let's get off the field. You know,
yeah. Yeah, because you see it coming, and that's right. I mean, it's one of the old better safe than sorry mentality, and it, sometimes it's better just to go ahead and, you know, maybe at 1 or 2 degrees off, but you see it coming. So I think Representative Fergal has it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for being here. It was a pleasure talking with you earlier as well. Coach Douglas and myself are in that 50-plus range. So, coaches, when we're coming up, old school, if you cramped up during the game, that meant extra running on Monday because they said you out of shape. Sometimes they withhold water. Are you running? I know you are knocking some heads, making sure coaches are, this is the most important thing. But are you running into, early on or even now, coaches that say, all right, well, this is what the rule is, but this is what we're going to do. That still has some of that old school mentality.
Well, it's funny you say it in that way, because I was coached by the old school coaches as well, so kind of.
Look how pretty you turned out. Look at that smile, man.
Kind of twofold with that. One, coaching in Fulton County is a supplemental position, and I say it all the time. Your 9-to-5 check is what pays your bills. Your supplemental position because you love it. Don't lose your job, your career job, for the supplemental position and not using common sense. That's number one. Number two, I tell the coaches, you know, I like the news channels, but I don't want to be on 2-5 or 11 or 46 because you didn't make the right judgment call about a kid's second. And that's because, like I said, you know, you have to take the approach that, though, this is someone's child and you have to use common sense. I mean, like I said, there was a time when, you know, coaches say, hey, you might be a little soft or whatever the case may be.
Well, they would actually say that.
Right.
They would actually say that.
They probably used another word.
Correct.
You know, not able to be spoken while we're on camera.
So, you know, like I said, now, you know, we have some of our best athletes, just like I said, Friday night at Creekside, that were cramping up. I mean, they probably got less than 5% body fat, but they were cramping up just because it's a day and age that's changed. They're lifting weights, they're running, they're drinking. We keep body armor and another protein shake in our weight room for the kids to try to supplement that they're not eating correctly at lunch. So we try to do all the measures we can as a school, but it's still inevitable that you want to just be prepared for it. Just make sure that we're in place and we're doing everything we're supposed to do.
I thank you for doing that, Mr. Chairman. I thank you for doing that because it's a culture change from some of you coaches.
Correct.
It's getting away from that mentality that, you know, if I'm cramping up, I cannot will that cramp go away.
Right.
It doesn't mean I'm soft.
Right.
And thank you for having the ice baths available.
Yeah.
And I think the USA has done a great job, and we'll find out more about the awful incident that happened later, I'm sure. But what GHA said, and the schools that have an alarm that will go off. And when the alarm goes off, you stop and you go inside into practice. I thank you for knocking heads and changing the culture and looking after our kids.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. And Coach Green or AD Green, I want to say thank you for being here today and thank you for all that you do. I know the young lady, Ms. Bell, was practicing for a basketball team, but she passed away, and that was the hottest day on record, I think, in the history of this world, that particular day, August the 13th. And I would like to say on record that Westlake High School, for the last 2 years, have had a state championship girls basketball team, and they actually made the Nationals last year. But I want to say thank you for doing it the right way. I've been very experienced with Westlake, being a proud Banneker High Trojan, 1995, playing you all in football and not rebelling back then, but I think a lot better now. But thank you all for being here, and thank you for all that you do.
So real quick, I hadn't seen the score. How did the game go Friday night?
Westlake 23, Creekside 22.
What? Congratulations.
Sorry if you're from Creekside, we apologize.
Well, as far as I have for an agenda, that's everybody that signed up to speak. Is there anybody in the audience that has a little something to say while you're here? We've got a little bit of time here, so we'd be glad to allow you to come up and speak. I believe we have a gentleman from College Park, maybe. Come on, Director. You helped us with the sound. You might as well come up and be heard. You can.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Emmanuel Range. I'm coming from the great city of College Park. My mayor here is Mayor Jack Longino. Also recognize him as well. Thank you all for having us. Can't say any more than what my colleague Tony Phillips said in the city of South Florida. They have a great concept of what they're doing. We're doing pretty much the same thing. We've been a city already established in football. I see one of your colleagues here. He's definitely from the area of Lakeshore High School, and Tony as well, from the community. We've always held the standard of ice baths and having the ice available at our parks. So we do have the ice machines and ice at our facilities that we have. Other than that, we're doing pretty much the same thing. We have another facility we can send our kids to, a convention center where we need to practice indoors. So we use that as well. Other than our mayor and council are very, very supportive of what we're doing and making sure we keep the kids safe in our football and football club programs and soccer for y'all. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate you very much. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I want to say thank you for bringing this to Mark Park and bringing this to our community, the study committee. Thank you, Representative William Bodie, for being a huge advocate on this issue. The city is only 2 years old, or 2.5 years old, and one of the things that I took on as a policymaker when I got elected was the Park and Recreation Ordinance. And so you heard Mr. Phillips say that certain protocols are put in the ordinance. It's law. We don't have a choice. The other thing that I have done was try to go out and seek quality coaches. And so that's why we have Marquise Grissom back in our park. That's over our baseball program. He's a Major League Baseball player. He knows how to play the game professionally. And I know, I have trust that he's not going to do anything to put our youth in danger. And I'm seeking a former professional athlete or either an athlete, a professional football athlete that would like to come back and take over our football program at some point. I am determined to make sure that Mr. Jonas Harper's death is not in vain. This will never happen again in this city, on this field. It did not happen when we were a city, but the fact that it happened on this field was something that I am not proud of, and I'm determined to make sure it doesn't happen again as a representative for this district. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that concludes this meeting. We appreciate you being here today. We have lunch provided by the park in the room right to the right. Thank you very much.